God is me one more time. I come right now, ask you that you will forgive me for any sins that I have committed. God, let me be pure. God, let me stand before your people tonight, not out of God trying to be somebody else, but let me be great. I ask you that you will let Greg decrease so that you might increase. God, I hope something that be said tonight that touches somebody's heart, that helps somebody in this place on tonight. God, I ask that they would see Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated on tonight. It's good to be into the house of the Lord just one more time. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and I declare that there is no other name amongst heaven or earth that man might be saved. It's good to be here. Thank God for this preaching moment. Also thank God for my brother for calling and trusting me with this task on tonight. There are many other capable preachers and pastors in this area that he could have called on, but I thank him. Thank God for putting my name on his heart. Tonight, I just said I have my wife and my daughter. She's here tonight. Madison and Jocelyn, y'all wait. You got to stand back up. Brother Angus, Mark, it's good to see you, man. Come on up. He's a preacher. He's one of the sons of the house at Good Hope as well. Thank God for him. As Pastor Sylvester said that I preached him before, I had just been preaching for seven to eight months, I believe, the last time I came. Had some mighty big shoes up here that night. I was standing in for my pastor. He had had surgery, and he wasn't able to preach just yet. And so when I got that text message, I was like, oh, Lord, I'm And so I thought, I'm like, yeah, I ain't never going back the same year. And so I guess you gave me a chance to come and redeem myself on tonight. But I solicit your prayers and your amens.
Yes, sir.
Not to hold you long, matter of fact, I'm all done. The theme for this revival is serving the Lord with excellence. In Scripture, 1 Corinthians 15:58 says, therefore, my beloved brother, be ye steadfast, unmoved, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Grass withereth, flowers fade away, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Not to hold you too long tonight, I just want to say something to try to help and encourage you on tonight, just to hang on in there. Just to hang on in there. In every believer's life, I don't care how saved you are. I don't care how holy you're supposed to be. You have, once upon a time, or maybe might even tonight, be experiencing or have experienced a moment of weakness. Matter of fact, like I said, if you be honest tonight, you can attest to the fact that maybe you have asked yourself the question whether or not it's worth living this Christian life. Not just living this Christian life, but living it in total submission to God. Yes, I hear you singing that song that Hezekiah Walker wrote about a few years ago, I'm sold out. My heart is fixed. My mind's made up. No room, no vacancies. I'm all filled up. But the question I have for you tonight, say I'm here, is: are you sold out or are you selling out? Are you out or are you selling out? There's a possibility that you may have wondered then, what you are doing for Christ, does it have any value? Does it have any significance? Maybe the thought has crossed your mind that, I don't know about this life of righteousness.
Well,
I might want to try another life. I might want to try that life of sin, life that where I can do stuff the way I want it, when I want it, and satisfy my own cravings. But I want to submit to you tonight, that's not it. That's not it. Apostle Paul, he writes in verse 57 that God gives victory not only over the guilt of sin, but he also gives the power over sin.
Yes, sir.
And so now what happened is, my sisters and brothers, we move from doctrine to directive.
Right.
I'm not trying to impress y'all, man. I'm just going to let you know I did study on Catholic. In other words, the doctrine of the resurrection of Christ, it impels us to action.
Well, yeah.
It says, my beloved brethren. This phrase, my beloved brethren, is particularly affectionate. In my study, I found out that Paul uses the phrase here. He uses the phrase only here and in Philippians 4 and 1, and he uses just the word brethren 28 times in 1 Corinthians, but here in the text he calls them beloved brethren. Now, I'm sure that it was difficult for Paul to call that carnal crowd beloved, because he knew how they felt towards one another. And I want to tell you tonight, we have an obligation as born-again believers to love all of the born-again believers that's around us.
Yes,
are y'all hearing me?
Yes,
now, we don't have to agree with them, but we have an obligation to love them. And since Christ died and won the victory over the death and the grave, and for us in return, at least we can do it, give him some glory, some honor, and we can do our best to serve him in excellence. Even in times, sometimes it might seem as if your work goes unnoticed. Maybe it seems as if you are not appreciated, or maybe it seems as if what you are doing has no value. But just remember this, only what you do for Christ will last. Not what you do for the pastor. Not what you do for mama, me, mom, papa, now. But what you do for Christ, that's what's going to last. Oh, I know when I've been in preparing this sermon, Pastor, I had to look at this. I'm like, oh man, I'm preaching to myself. Can I be transparent? Because I was just having some thoughts not too long ago. I'm like, wait a minute. I know I'm better than.
Come on,
Doc. Oh. I'm like, come on now. I've been doing this. Ain't no, you ain't said nothing to me.
Well,
you know. But it's what you do for Christ.
Yes.
I would rather the accolades from Christ.
Amen.
Than the accolades from me. Brothers and sisters, Paul tells the Corinthian church to do three things. And if we are going to serve the Lord with excellence, even in times of despair, even in moments of dismay, I want to submit and suggest to you these three things tonight. You got time? The first thing Paul tells them is to be ye steadfast. It's self-explanatory right here in the text. Point number one, if you're going to serve the Lord with excellence, you got to be planted.
That's right.
Everybody shout
planted.
Let's look at the word be first. Be, the word be is suggested here to become.
Heard.
All right.
To become, that means that evidently they hadn't already arrived. Or they hadn't made it there yet. They are to become because they were not stable.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And as Christians, we should be stable in our faith because of the resurrection.
Yeah.
You do know what the resurrection is, don't you? Well, let me say it this way. Before you can become planted, you have to have a solid foundation. Are you with me? And I want to suggest to the Christian that the Christian has a foundation to stand on and to believe in. And you know what that foundation is tonight, don't you? That foundation is our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. The God that we serve is not dead, but alive and well, and he has risen. Oh, I can hear mama singing that old song. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ and his righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but a holy thing on Jesus' name. I thought this was a Baptist church. All Christ, the solid rock outstand. All of the ground is sinking sand. Okay, maybe that was a little too old for some of y'all. God sent his son. They call him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is here to prove that my Savior lived. This is what I like. Because he lived, I can face tomorrow. Because he lived, I'm fearless gone. Because I know who holds the future, and life is worth living. Tonight, we as Christians have a solid foundation through the price that was paid, and we have the ability to serve him with excellence.
Yeah.
By the way, the phrase "be ye" is in the imperative mood.
Right.
It suggests a command.
Yeah.
It suggests a command. In other words, we have no choice in these matters.
Well,
be ye said.
Yeah.
We ain't got no say so in this.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
If we are commanded,
yes, sir,
to be planted, to be steadfast. If we want to be the people that God has redeemed us to be, then we must walk in hope, letting the light of Christ shine brightly for the lost world to see.
Yeah.
Okay, since y'all so quiet, ask me how I know. Because I read the Bible, Matthew 5:16 says, let your light so shine that before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Guess what? God did not save you just to sit there on that pew like a robot. You can come down the aisle, give your hand to the preacher and your heart to God just to do nothing. God saved you and I to be busy for him. Yes, there is something for you to do in the kingdom of God. God did not bring you here without a purpose in your life. Y'all kind of quiet, y'all like that. There is something for you that's not doing anything for you to do in the household of God. My brothers and sisters, if you continue in faith, stay grounded, stay planted, and stay steadfast, you won't have to worry if somebody doesn't like what you do. You don't have to worry if you get a little weak sometimes. You can still serve the Lord if you stay grounded. Well, we are called upon to make up our minds to take a stand for the Lord.
Amen.
You ain't got to take my word for it. I got three witnesses. They took the stand. You know who they are, don't you? They got mighty high on them. They turned up the heat. But they still took a stand for the Lord. And I want to come and tell y'all tonight, we need some more people, some more church folk that's already been in church, that's already coming to church, to take a stand. See, the church needs to take a stand. And we don't have to worry about these gun laws. We ain't got to worry about number 45. We got to take a stand. Each and every one of us is here tonight, again I say, has a purpose.
Yeah.
And we have something to live for.
All right.
That's from the youngest to the oldest. We have a reason to take a stand and to be steadfast. And I want to encourage each and every one of you in here tonight to do just that. Not only he tells them to be, my beloved brother, to be ye steadfast, but secondly, he tells them to be immovable. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. In other words, I got to put these two together.
Okay.
You got to be persistent and fruitful.
All right.
Come on. All right. Hold on. There you are. Get in right there. I gave you a pea. I gave you 2 peas. I got 5 or 3 feet. You got to be planted. Secondly, you got to be persistent.
All right. All right.
You got to be productive.
All right. All right.
All right.
Planted, persistent, and productive.
Yeah.
Together.
Immovable is simply another word for stability. Told you I'm preaching to myself now. There are many times when stubbornness is not appropriate. And the times when stubbornness is not appropriate. But now I've been the devil. But in the Lord's business, in the Lord's work, a good case of stubbornness is perfectly in order. We must allow nothing to move us from our determination to serve the Lord. We must not allow nobody to move us from our determination to serve the Lord. Even if they sleep in the same bed with you tonight. Even if they got your same last name. Mama, I love you, but
yes.
I charge you to keep my hand. I love you, but I got a mission. I'm on a mission. Baby, I love you, but the Lord has called me to do something. We must not let nobody deter us from the work of the Lord. To be honest, the word immovable carries more weight than steadfast. Abounding has the idea of exceeding a certain amount. Overflowing. Let me say it like this. Going above and beyond. When we consider what we have and who we are by grace,
When we think about how he poured out his grace on us when he saved us, the least we can do is to go all out for him and serve.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
The least.
The least we can do.
Yes, sir.
When you look back over your life,
yeah,
and see how the Lord has blessed you,
yeah,
when you can say to yourself, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, well, if that's the case, you ought to be able to give him your very best.
Yeah.
It's amazing to me that how us so-called church folk, we tend to give God a little old anything. Especially during offering time.
You're right.
We pull out bonds and coins and dollars.
Come on, Dad. Yes, sir.
He gave you his only begotten son.
Amen.
He gave, I love everybody in here, and don't know half of y'all's name. I even love Delilah. But I guarantee you, if this comes up to you all or my daughter Madison, y'all got to go. God gave you his precious son, his most prized possession. And we turn around and give him, that'll do. Oh, that's enough to get by attitude. Oh, well, I did that last. Let somebody else do it. We got to give God our very best. Even if it costs you something. Even if you get a little uncomfortable. I just told you what you do for Christ will last. Oh, even if we must be wrong. And let me be wrong on the side, on the Lord's side.
Yeah.
If you're going to be on fire, be on too much fire for the Lord. Be extreme for the Lord. Yes, it is impossible to go too far with Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Wow. That is a simple message. I didn't even text preach yourself.
Impossible.
It is impossible to go too. You can't go far enough.
Yeah.
You can't go far enough with Jesus. The least we can do is give him everything we have for his glory. I do mean everything. Shout everything. That's your time, your money, your energy, your talents, your gifts, your bodies, your mind, your heart, and your soul. You should be investing in all and nothing but Jesus. The news is,
hold
on, come on. The good news is, there is some hope.
Yes, sir.
If this life is all there is, if there is no hope for eternity, no rapture, no possibility of a resurrection, if all we have to look forward to is the grave, then we would have a reason to give up. Then we would have a reason to throw in the towel. Oh, then we would have a reason to be in despair and dismay. But Paul proclaims boldly, there is a resurrection. You know the resurrection, don't you? Jesus was raised from the grave. And there is hope for those who have faith in Christ tonight. Notice what the promises of hope are pertaining to the Christian.
Go ahead.
You have a hope. Gives us confidence.
Right.
Yeah.
Paul tells them that we know that our work for the Lord matters. There is no sacrifice. There is no struggle. No effort. No work.
Yeah.
Nothing that you do goes unnoticed, and none will fail to pay eternal benefits. Oh man, I knew I had y'all right there. I knew y'all were shouting that right there. I'm gonna say that again. There is no sacrifice, there is no struggle, no effort, no work that goes unnoticed, and that none of that will fail to pay eternal benefits. So I want to tell you, just keep on praying. Keep on serving. Keep on living with Jesus. Because what you do for him and his name in time, well, it's not in vain. In other words, it's not a waste of time. What you're doing for Christ is not a waste of time. Because guess what? He sees all and he knows all. And the good news is, child of God, one day he's going to reward all. He is watching, and if we are doing all that we do for him and his glory, we can be sure that he sees it all. That gives us the confidence to keep on serving him regardless of what life brings your way. Keep on serving him as they talk about you, they lie on you. Keep on serving him if they turn your nose up at you. Keep on working on that committee if they say, well, she always doing this or he's always doing that. Keep on serving whether or not they like you. Keep on serving whether or not they recognize you. Keep on serving whether or not they pat you on the back. Because what you do for Christ will last.
Right.
24 minutes. All right.
That's all right.
Secondly, the word used to describe it here in this word is labor. The word means intense labor united with trouble and toil.
Yes, sir.
Let me bring it down to your terms. It has the idea, Pastor Sylvester, of work that results in pain and agony. The mark is not going to always be easy.
Yes, all right, preacher.
Yes, yes.
Sometimes you're going to want to throw in the towel. But just hang on in that. Sometimes our walk with the Lord is just that. There are some times when it seems that no one notices or no one cares. There are times when you may feel unappreciated and that you are carrying out a thankless task. In those times, I'm going to tell you to walk in confidence because the Lord is watching.
Yes, sir.
And when he comes,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
He will reward you.
Yeah.
He will say thank you. If we walk with him, if we work for him and wait patiently for him, and the day will come when he will say, well done. Good and faithful servant, thou hast been faithful over a few things, and I will make thee ruler over many. I don't know about you tonight, but that's what I want to hear. Servant, well done.
Yes, sir.
Well, clock on the wall says that's all. It's been fun. I got to run. But before I take my seat, I want to tell you tonight, God does not pay commissions. I posted this on Facebook the other night. God does not pay commissions. He pays salaries. I'm going to let y'all think about it for a while. God does not pay commissions. He only pays salaries. He pays you for the labor that you did, not for the results of the labor.
I see.
Just the fact that you labored for him.
Come on.
Just the fact that you kept on holding the door when the people ready to come in, they hit you in the back. Just because of the fact that you kept singing when it seemed like you didn't do, when nothing was going right for you, you wanted to give up. In spite of your personal life, in spite of what you had going on, you kept serving the Lord. In spite of when they talked about you, when they lied on you, you kept preaching the word of God. When they didn't want to hear you, you kept preaching, you kept deaconing. When they said, well, he's the only one that prays, you kept doing whatever you were doing. The Lord is going to pay you for laboring. Therefore, abound in the work of the Lord. Because it's never in vain. Give me your flat, we're going to get out of here. I want to tell somebody tonight, if there is something that you haven't been doing, you need to start. If there is something that you've stopped doing, you need to start back. Because we got somebody. I'm gonna keep on praying. I'm gonna keep on singing.
give it to the Lord
and
do it for Him, He'll bless it. Whatever your gift is, whatever your talent is, it's not too small. Ask how to know. Because I get fired. You got two little fish, five loaves of bread. And the bread is not the loaf of life bread that we're thinking about. It was little biscuits. He took that and fed a multitude. But the idea here is, you got to give it to the Lord. And He blesses it. Whatever you have to offer for Him in service, give it. They used to sing a song, I'll go. Maybe small, but I'll go. Maybe burden. This Christian journey, it's not going to be easy. The road is not rough. I mean, the road is not smooth. It's not wide. It's narrow. You're going to have some obstacles come. You're going to have some tests, some trials, some persecution. The Bible says that if you live for Christ, you will suffer. Not you may suffer, you might suffer, it's a possibility. You're going to suffer if you're going to live for Jesus.
Right.
I just want to encourage you tonight to just say, I ain't going in there. The Lord will pay. Your work and your living is not in vain. Amen.